Magandang hapon, Joy. Kamusta? So, ngayon ay ipagpapatuloy natin ang pag-aaral sa ating subject na moral issues and concerns in contemporary living. Last time ay diniscuss natin ang moral dimension ng mga contraceptives at ano ang stand ng Roman Catholics sa contraceptions at yung stands ng evangelical sa contraceptions. Okay? Ngayon ay pag-aaralan natin ang tungkol naman sa reproductive technologies, yung tinatawag na artificial insemination. Kailan nagsimula ang artificial insemination? Ano ang mga medical consideration tungkol dito at ano ang legal implication of artificial insemination of donors at ano naman ang moral dimension nito sa mga Roman Catholic at sa mga Protestant. Okay, but before we proceed, let us pray to God and acknowledge His presence sa ating pag-aaral. Tayo manalangin, Ama naming banal, Diyos na makapangyarihan sa lahat. Salamat po Lord sa hapong ito, sa opportunity na iyong ibinibigay sa amin upang mag-aral kami ng mga bagay-bagay, Panginoon, tungkol sa mga issues and concern na aming na-encounter, Lord. And Father, we pray na you give us the wisdom, knowledge, Lord, and information so that, Lord God, magamit namin ang mga pinag-aaralan namin ito sa aming buhay. Most especially, Lord God, si Joy in the future ay magiging isang teacher, so she can help other people decide right sa kanilang mga buhay, Panginoon. Thank you, Lord God, and we hope and we pray na sasamahan niyo po kami, Panginoon, in our study sa hapong ito, Panginoon. Thank you, Father God, and we pray that your grace and mercy be upon us. Thank you, Lord God, and this we pray in Jesus' name. Amen and amen. Okay, so let us discuss the reproductive technologies. So, noong 1967, mayroong isang Nobel Prize winner na ang pangalan, isang biologist, si George Wald of Harvard, ay nakaimbento ng tinatawag na isang sperm bank. Okay? So, itong sperm bank na ito ay nagkaroon ng panalo. Nanalo siya sa isang patimpalak at sabi niya ay importante at siya ay nag-advocate ng storage of the sperm, no? In order that carefully selected women might later have the opportunity of producing superior children. So, yan yung purpose ng sperm bank. Dito ay merong tinatawag na artificial insemination. So, the responses to the creation of a Nobel sperm bank have been very mixed. Many have seen in such development a stepping stone towards the world of the 1984 or Brave New World. Noted Father Richard McCormick Professor of Christian Ethics at Georgetown University, he said, "When we do that, we turn ourselves into shoppers and our children into purchases. A people that thus is on its way to doing a lot more that civilized people ought not to do." So para kay Father Richard McCormick ay hindi daw pwede itong gawin. Okay, pero yung nag-a-advocate ng artificial insemination ay ito daw ay isang magandang gawin upang ang mga kababaihan ay makapili, no, ng superior children. Okay? So, kaya ang tawag dito sa Harvard ay the Nobel Sperm Bank. Nobel Sperm Bank. So, the Nobel Sperm Bank is one of the more flamboyant examples of the use of the artificial insemination, a reproductive technology that has come into widespread use in the United States in the 20th century and especially in the last decade. So, it has been estimated that there are more than 250,000 people in America whose lives began through the use of this technique. So, napakarami, no? 250,000 people. So, each year, some 15,000 to 20,000 babies are said to be conceived in the United States through artificial insemination. So, mapapansin natin, ang exact figure na ito ay mahirap i-obtain since the whole procedure is usually veiled in secrecy. So, hindi siya masyadong accurate kasi pwedeng maging sobra pa sa 15,000 to 20,000 babies ang ipinapanganak. Kasi nga, ang procedure na ito ay ginagawa ng sikreto. Okay? There are at least a dozen commercial sperm bank operating around America, which buy, sell, and store frozen sperm. In addition to many others associated with universities and fertility clinics. So the largest of this business is Idant in New York City, where more than 30,000 vials of frozen sperm from more than 3,000 men are in storage. So, di ba? Napakarami. At ito ay existing sa New York. So, ayon sa isang article sa Advertising Age, no? Ang pamagat ng article ay Advertising Age, dalawang commercial sperm bank na pupuno over 100 orders per month. Okay, 100 orders per month, and one is preparing to market sperm directly to consumers. Now, in the near future, it is quite possible that do-it-yourself home insemination kit could be available for purchase off the shelf. No, pwede na in the future ay hindi na sa clinic gagawin yung artificial insemination sapagkat meron ng do-it-yourself. Okay, so yung tinatawag na home insemination kits. So, ang discussion tungkol sa artificial insemination usually distinguish between artificial insemination by husband and artificial insemination by donor. So, dalawa yan. Isang husband at saka isang donor. No? At itong artificial insemination by donor, ito yung karimitan nagre-raise ng moral, acute, ethical questions. Ito yung pinag-uusapan. No? Some observers have noted that the term donor is something of a misnomer, inasmuch as the typical donor is not donating his sperm at all. Bakit? Kasi binibenta nila yung kanilang mga sperm sa mga commercial firm sa halagang $25 per sample. So kaya hindi siya donor dahil binibenta yung kanyang sperm sa mga commercial firm. So, merong isang young graduate students ng UCLA, kumikita siya ng $50 every week by stopping, no, by at the Southern California Cruyo Bank twice a week in order to sell 2 samples of his sperm. So, si Greg, hindi niya ito tunay na pangalan. Sabi niya, without sounding too conceited, I'm healthy, I'm intelligent, I have good genes, and I'd like to pass them along. So, yan yung kanyang sinasabi kung bakit nagbebenta siya ng kanyang sperm, dahil healthy raw siya, matalino raw siya, meron raw siya magandang genes, at gusto niya raw itong maipasa sa ibang tao. So, the demand for artificial insemination has been increasing in recent years for a number of reasons, no? Number one, because of declining levels of fertility and legalized abortion. Okay, as well as a growing tendency of unwed mothers to keep their children. There has been a shrinking supply of babies for adoption. No, bumababang bilang ng mga na-adopt. So couples with fertility problems are increasingly turning to other means. Halimbawa, noong 1970, yung state of California ay merong 5,500 babies under 6 months of age for adoption through its various agencies. No, 1970, merong 5,500 babies na ready for adoption. Pero noong 1978, after 8 years, yung number ng mga baby ay mga umabot lang ng 818. So makikita ninyo, nakikita mo yung pagbaba ng mga babies for adoption. Okay, another significant factor in the increasing demand for artificial insemination by donors ay the increasing in male infertility. It is estimated that 1 man in 10 in the United States is sterile. 50 to 100 million sperm cell per cubic centimeter of semen was common among healthy American males 15 years ago. Okay? Ngayon, ang figure na yan maybe be about half that. So, kalahati na lang. Various reasons for this decline have been suggested, including environmental factors such as the increasing use of pesticides, chemicals in food, and heightened level of stress. But the exact cause or causes are not known. So, iyan yung mga reason bakit yung artificial insemination ay patuloy na lumalakas at lumalago. So, may mga pag-aaral ng practice ng artificial insemination doon sa national level ay nagsasuggest na ang pagkagamit ng artificial insemination for donor by donors by unmarried woman is not limited to California. For example, a 1977 survey of 379 physicians who performed artificial insemination by donors disclosed that 10% of the cases involved are single women. Sabi nila, no, sinabi ni Dr. Jaroslav Marik, isang director of the Tyler Medical Clinic in Los Angeles, sabi niya, 5 years ago, an unmarried patient requesting insemination was unheard. No? 5 years ago, hindi raw naririnig yung patient na mag-request ng artificial insemination. Pero sa ngayon, we do have some coming in. We have no policy of refusing or accepting it. Depends on the situation. So, you see na even unmarried woman ay nagre-request for artificial insemination, okay, sa Amerika. Sa atin, marami ng mga ganyang uri ng sitwasyon. For example, kung malalaman mo or kung alam mo, si Corina Sanchez nagkaroon ng artificial insemination. Okay? Yung mga nagsasamang mga tomboy at mga babae, nag-artificial insemination. Halimbawa, si Joel Cruz, may-ari ng pabango, isang mayamang bakla. Pero siya ay nagkaroon ng maraming anak sa pamamagitan ng artificial insemination. Okay? So, ang mga lesbian whose request for artificial insemination, no, has been refused by the physician have turned to feminist or homosexual organizations such as the one in Oakland or others elsewhere in Mother's Defense Fund in Seattle. Sabi niya, we had gay men call to and offer to be donors. When the father is gay, he may act as co-parent. The child may live sometimes with the man and sometimes with a woman and another party not biologically involved. So, ganyan yung ginagawa ng mga LGBT. Okay? So, ano naman yung history? Bakit nagkaroon ng idea ang mga tao tungkol sa artificial insemination? Ano yung history? Saan nila nakuha? Saan nila pinasimulan ang artificial insemination? The history of artificial insemination dates back to the later part of the 18th century, no? Noong 18th century, in the case of humans and possibly as far back as the 14th century for animals, no? So 18th century, nagpasimula ang artificial insemination sa mga tao, pero noong 14th century, pinasimulan ito sa mga animals. It is said that Arabian horse breeders in the 14th century successfully inseminated a mare with the semen of a stallion. Okay? In 1776, the Italian priest and biologist Lazzaro Spallanzani succeeded in producing tadpoles by pouring semen on the eggs of a frog. Spallanzani performed the experiments to disprove ideas that were then current concerning sexual reproduction. It was believed that flies and worms arose through spontaneous generation from decaying matters, that birds and reptiles were generated from the egg of the female alone, no? And that the higher animals were produced by the male semen incubated in the female, no? 4 years after his experiment with frogs, Spallanzani successfully artificially inseminated a dog. So ang concept ng artificial insemination ay pwede pala na magkaroon ng baby nang hindi nagkakaroon ng sexual intercourse, no? So the first successful experiment in human artificial insemination was performed by an English surgeon, John Hunter, in 1790. An American, Marion Sims, performed such an insemination in 1866, but was forced to abandon the practice because of the public outcry it produced. So it means noong 18th century ay ginawa sa tao ang kauna-unahang artificial insemination. Okay? So, yung artificial insemination techniques sa mga hayop, katulad sa mga kabayo, sa mga baka, sa mga tupa, at sa mga baboy, ay na-refined sa Russia during the first decades of the 20th century. So, ang techniques na ito ay naging commonplace since noong 1930s. Halimbawa, sa Denmark, merong mga 95% ng mga baka na nagproproduce ng mga gatas ay ginawa sa pamamagitan ng artificial insemination. At sa England at sa Wales, mga 70% ang ginawa ng mga tao sa pamamagitan ng pagkaparami ng mga baka. Sa United States naman ay merong mga 65 hanggang 70% na gumagawa ng artificial techniques sa mga hayop. So ang gamit ng artificial insemination sa mga animal breeding ay nakamit, okay, noong 1949 na nagplato. Nasabi nila that semen could be frozen for storage and easily transported in this form. It has lead to superior stocks and increased productivity. So, naging mas marami ang mga hayop. Okay? So, the semen from one superior bull can be used to inseminate thousands of dairy cattle. So, ganyan yung nangyayari, no? Ayon kay William M. Durfee ng National Association of Animal Breeders in Columbia, Maryland, the number of dairy cattle, sabi niya, has actually declined, but we now produce, no, as much milk as we did 25 years ago with half as many cattle. So, such artificial insemination techniques hold considerable promise for creating milk and meat production in the developing nation. So, whether such techniques should be extended to human beings in order to produce superior stock is, of course, an entirely different questions, no? And continues to generate much debate both in scientific circle and in the public at large. So, ano naman ang medical consideration ng reproductive technology na ito sa pamamagitan ng artificial insemination? Ang desire para sa artificial insemination ay nag-a-arise, no, from a medical consideration. Halimbawa, a woman inability to conceive through normal sexual intercourse, no, may result from vaginal tumor, scarring of the vagina, or pwede ring abnormal position of the uterus, pwede ring a small cervical opening or obesity. No? Pangalawa na pwede i-consider ay yung man's impotence. Okay, malformed penis, low sperm count, or obesity may hinder the normal reproductive process. In a significant number of cases, couples request artificial insemination by donor when it is known that the man is a carrier of a genetic transmitted disease such as hemophilia, cystic fibrosis, Huntington's chorea, or certain forms of muscular dystrophy. So, kaya nagre-request sila ng mga tinatawag na artificial insemination. In recent years, the use of frozen sperm has been more common in the insemination procedure. The frozen sperm can be tested for genetic defects and contagious diseases that could harm either the mother or the child. So, iyan yung medical consideration na kung bakit nila ginagawa yung tinatawag na artificial insemination. Okay, ano naman ang legal implication of artificial insemination by donor? So, as with other modern reproductive technologies, artificial insemination raises many complex legal questions, many of which remain unresolved. So, ang legal trend sa Amerika sa ngayon is to recognize as legitimate a child conceived through artificial insemination by donors when the mother's husband has consent to the procedure. So, actually, yun lang yung issue doon na dapat i-consider na legitimate ng asawa, okay?